You've got Minnesota in the foreground. Etienne G. Undine. Can't see who's next to Undine. K Woman is standing, so that's Jerry to do. Five Pier, Shiny Joe, Prad, David, Kathleen, Briggs, Jeff against the wall. Oh, Jeffa. Let's see which one he is. We've got Evelyn in the foreground. Rajetha, so let's. Next to her is Rojetha, now standing. Mir-o-Bot in the far right. Next group is Philip GR, Podhopper, Eternal Seeker, Spetzel, who just stood up, Antdroid against the pillar, and Wolfgang in front of Antdroid and between Spetzel and Briggs. Magic Crystalline is not in view, and Magic Piri has not arrived to this area yet. All right, we've got Paige, Lip, Squabby, Terrafel, Synapse, Dr. Chris Care, AH, Kiwi, Elizabeth Green, Sally Rogers, Loritz, Tiger Lily, Scott Miller, Antdroid, J-Trig, Mufasa, Thoa Kenum, Potru, Caver, and Cave Woman. Tonight's story is brought to you in part by MistLore.com for some of the history, DPWR.net for the Dine dates, BuruArchives.com for the surface history corresponding to the Dine dates, and the Cavernian Calendar Converter, which was written by Brett Middleton of the Fuzzy Physics Institute for converting between Dine and surface time. Tonight's story is from the Game of Myst. As I've told these stories, we've learned about life in the cavern. We learned how the Dine came from their proud roots, seeking to shed their pride, yet pride crept back into their lives. We watched it cause the downfall of their great empire. After the fall, pride lived on. Though Anna, known throughout Dine as Tiana, did her best to raise her young son Gan to be a decent person, the fact remained that he blamed her for the fall of the empire, as well as for his father's death. The few short years he spent living and learning the ways of Dine writing, Seltav, in the Guild of Books, was enough to plant the seed of pride within him. Fixated on that blame, he viewed his mother's meddling in Dine politics as the root cause of the fall. As such, his mind was closed to any instruction she might give him. Without any guidance, his pride, for what he believed the greatness of Dine to be, grew. We learned of Atreus's early years spent with his grandmother Anna as she taught him to grow up to be the man he became. We also learned of his teenage years spent with his father, Gan. It took some time, but eventually Atreus saw just how mad his father had become, drunk with the idea of power, of ruling over 1,000 ages as a god. We learned of his plans to save Katrin, whom he called Catherine, and the multiverse from his father's machinations. We learned how his grandmother, Anna, had met Catherine, and the two women made their own plans to not only rescue the multiverse, but Atreus as well. After trapping Gen on Riven, we saw Atreus and Catherine make a home for themselves on Anna's Age of Myst. After a few years, Achenar, then Cirrus was born, and Anna helped them raise their boys. Atreus and Catherine kept writing ages, attempting to perfect their mastery of the art. Tonight, We will watch the descent into arrogance, greed, and madness. As we learned last week, Atreus's eldest son, Achenar, was born in the Dani year of 9432, approximately 1777 AD. He was named after the star Achenar. His younger brother, Cyrus, was born in the Dani year of 9434, approximately 1779 AD. The two brothers were at opposite ends of the emotional spectrum. Achenar was very emotional and, as he got older, he became prone to fits of rage. On the other hand, Cyrus was more rational. As Cyrus became older, he became colder and more calculating and devious. When Atreus wrote the Age of Everdunes, he made a friend in the form of a woman named Pran, the leader of her people. He eventually took his sons to meet his new friend. Everdunes was a desert age filled with unending sand dunes. The people there lived underground. He also found strange crystals. He thought he could use the crystals to remotely view other ages. Unfortunately, because of the high heat, his experiments failed. Since he had written an age of ice and snow, which he had named Rhyme, he decided to move his experiments to that new age. Everything was fairly blissful for a number of years. Unfortunately, tragedy struck when the two boys were 8 and 10 years old. After visiting one of the ages that Catherine had written, Anna became gravely sick. Eventually, she succumbed to her illness. And so it was that in the Dani year of 9441, approximately 1786 AD, the only surface dweller to ever become a Dani citizen passed away. She was 91 years old. As I mentioned last week, Atreus and Catherine took it very hard. Catherine stopped writing altogether, and Atreus buried himself in his work, writing and visiting ages. The boys were pretty much left to themselves. Cyrus, who was 8 at the time, took this as rejection, but was too proud to let it show. Initially, they were a nuisance to Atreus's explorations, and he rarely took them with him. While building the mechanical age, Atreus decided to bring them for help since they had grown considerably since Everdunes. They built the fortress of mechanical, and during their spare time, they used to play with the supplies on the southern island and even make their own constructions. Atreus admired their ingenuity. They also accompanied him to the Age of Rhyme and helped him construct a number of towers and buildings there. When older, the brothers accompanied Atreus when he returned to Channelwood and got along very well with the tree dwellers, picking up their language fast. When Atreus left for Osmoian, Cyrus suggested that he and Achenar stay. Atreus warned them not to take advantage of the respect the tree dwellers have for their ideas. Atreus visited them once more after Everdunes. The tree dwellers were slightly distressed that he was leaving again, but were happy that Cyrus and Achenar were staying behind once more. When Atreus came back 3 days later after visiting a number of ages, the boys had constructed a boat with the tree dwellers and explored the surrounding waters. Atreus noted how excited they both seemed to be, and they reminded him of how he felt during his adventures as a child. Unfortunately, he had some bad news for his sons. Atris told them about Pran's death, and they were shocked. Her death troubled both of the boys. On their last night in Channelwood, they told Atris that they would like to come to Channelwood again. They also asked if they could visit some other ages alone. Atris needed to think over their request. He thought that they had proven themselves trustworthy and responsible. He wanted to discuss it with Catherine as well. Obviously, she agreed with Atris's assessment, as the boys were allowed to travel by themselves. The tree dwellers in Channelwood, a monkey-like people, held Atris and his sons in reverence. When Atris first came to that age, he met an ancient human whom the tree dwellers held with great reverence, almost as a god. That human died shortly after his arrival. It seems that the boys' experience on Channelwood had a profound effect on their psyches. The tree dwellers' reverence for them undoubtedly filled a need for attention that they were no longer receiving from their parents. The reverence that was so freely given to them by the tree dwellers soon became a need to be revered, and with it, a growing want for wealth and power. In an attempt to teach his sons the art of writing, Atris created the lesson ages and befriended Savedro of Narayan to educate the boys in the principles of environmental balance. He asked the teacher to help the brothers learn about Narayan's careful tending of the lattice tree so that they could understand the balance necessary for civilization. But the sons had too much freedom, and without their father's knowledge, they grew mad with visions of riches and power sprung forth by the endless possibilities of the books. They declared themselves kings of his ages, ruling and destroying their people. It was a time when Atris was busy with other things and left his Myst library unchecked for too long. When Cyrus and Akinar returned to Narayan as corrupted adults, they claimed that they could fix Narayan so that it could survive without having to work for its balance. These claims stirred up many of the young people against the elders, causing the neglect of the tree. When they left Narayan, Savedro, who had for some time been unsure whether or not to believe the brothers, made up his mind to confront them. Leaving his wife Tamra and his children, by this time he had had a second daughter, to seek shelter, he followed the brothers to Jannanan, the start of the Lesson Ages. There, they told him that they had no intention of helping Narayan and left him stranded in the age. Cyrus plundered the resources of the ages he subjugated and lived in luxury. He often clashed with his brother Akinar, whom he looked down on. Akinar, on the other hand, was disgusted by Cyrus's greed and even sent a threatening letter to him. It was at some point after this that they started burning the books in the library on Myst. When Atris found out, he was not ready to accuse one or the other. He hid the few surviving books in places of protection on the island, accessed by codes from the Myst Tower. Akinar, for his part, had become a bit cruel in his own right. Akinar's emotions often got the better of him, his anger often being the first displayed. Atreus then wrote two books, a garden age, which he called Haven, and an age that was filled with natural crystalline structures, which he called Spire. Then, using reverse psychology, he instructed each of his sons privately not to use those books. His plan was that whichever son was committing the destructive acts would be the one to disobey him and link to that age. Planning ahead, he wrote two ages, just in case both of his sons were at fault. In the Dene year of 9462, approximately 1807 AD, the brothers decided to eliminate their parents before they discovered what they had been doing. Putting aside their differences, Cyrus sought Achenar's help. They persuaded their mother that Atreus decided to link to the closed-off Riven and sent her there. Then they told Atreus that she was waiting for him in Kavir. While Atreus was preparing, Cyrus left a message to Achenar on his channelwood imager and notified him. Achenar then took one page from their father's Myst linking book, so Atreus could not link back to Myst. Atreus and Catherine were successfully trapped in Kavir and Riven, respectively, and Cyrus and Achenar began to work on the second part of their plan in Cyrenia to steal Atreus's memories from him and finally learn the art. While Achenar was working on the machine in Cyrenia, he considered taking, temporarily, the Life Stone from Cyrenia. He mentioned it to Cyrus, who accused Achenar of letting his, quote, insatiable desire for instant gratification, close quote, screw up yet another one of his plans, and then blamed his brother for the whole Narayan civil war. This argument made Achenar mad and ruined their plan. Cyrus then dared to link to Spire, fooled by the natural palaces and hoping for a civilization to conquer. Unfortunately for him, there was something missing from this age. His father had not left a linking book behind. Instead, he found himself trapped in the desolate prison age. After overcoming his first disappointment over a bonfire he built, he used a rope and descended a tunnel to find himself in a crystalline complex with no apparent exit. Achenar fared no better. His brother having linked to Spire, he decided that he would link to Haven. He had no desire to spend another minute with his arrogant and greedy brother. Unfortunately for Achenar, he fell to the same fate as Cyrus, trapped in an age without a linking book to get back home. This left Atreus trapped in Kavir, Catherine trapped in Riven, Achenar trapped in Haven, Cyrus trapped in Spire, and Myst Island, vacant. Please join us next week for When a Stranger Calls. The end. And thank you all for coming tonight, and to those of you watching this video at home. And time to end the story right now.